one for another feast. We've had one today, and I know we're ready for another. And so it is my great pleasure to welcome Father Peter Malone. And I have a bio here with a few additions and scratchings in it, so he might have to fix it. But I'm going to do my best. Peter was ordained as a missionary to Sacred Heart in 1955. He spent a year and a half in Rome after that, a year in 1966 teaching at Darabalam, 1968, the mass doesn't work out there, but the order's right, isn't it?
It was all 67 as well.
67 at Darabalam, and 68. He went to the MSC Seminary in Canberra to lecture in Scripture. From 72 to 88, he taught at Yarra Theological Union in Melbourne, as well as being on the staff of the National Pastoral Institute and the Heart of Life Spirituality Centre in Melbourne. In 1989, he was elected president of the International Catholic Organisation for Cinema and was elected world president in 1998. In 2001, he was elected as the first president of the World Catholic Association for Communication. He was the editor of Compass Theology Review from 71 to 98. He has written on theology, spirituality and cinema, especially films and values, movie Christs and antichrists. On screen and lights, camera, faith, the series called A Movie Lectionary and edited through a Catholic lens, religious perspectives of 19 film directors from around the world. Peter was awarded an honorary doctorate in theology from Melbourne College of Divinity in 2008. He is presently working for Cygnus Cinema Desk, and his topic today is Images of Heart Spirituality. So I hope I got most of that right.
That's good, thank you. Did you hear about the priest who gave the homily at Mass? And a little girl came up afterwards and said, "Here's $5. And he said, "Oh, no, no, I don't need that." Oh, she said, "My father said you're the poorest preacher he's ever heard." Frank Dineen tells jokes like that after Mass at Blackburn. But then one that I rather like in a similar vein, the lady came up after Mass and said to the priest, "That was quite a good sermon this morning." And he modestly said, "Oh, well, of course, it was the Holy Spirit." And she said, "It wasn't that good." So we'll see how we can manage. I'm going to try to do two things during this particular session. The first is I'd like to take you through the history of images of Jesus on screen. So from the 1890s, when there was the first public screenings in 1895 in Paris by the Lumiere brothers, little bits of about 1 minute each. And in the succeeding years, they started to make short films about biblical topics, biblical characters, but of course they haven't been preserved. Though in a minute I'm going to show you a clip from a documentary which will have some of those images from the early years of the cinema. And in going through to the present day, I would like to highlight that we're going to think about the kind of images that we saw, because they correspond, in a sense, to the changing spirituality, say, of the 20th century and into our own century. Emphasis on Jesus' divinity, or emphasis on Jesus' humanity, and the look of holy cards. But we'll trace that through, and I hope that'll be interesting, so that by the end, there won't be a test, but I hope you'll have some kind of overview of what has happened. But some of the clips I'm going to show you from different periods, I'll indicate how you might like to do, if you have to, a workshop or a seminar on Jesus on screen. I'm going to use some of the clips which will feature the woman taken in adultery from John chapter 8. If you have a longer time, and I was able to do this at Darumalan last year, and I did it with a group who belonged to the Sarah Club, average age 79. They're a lay group who promote vocations. But we had a retreat last year, and I've never had such a good response, because some of them said, oh yes, I remember when I saw that. Oh yes, I remember when I saw that. And so they were really very strong in participation. But I'll indicate how that might be done as we move through. So there are at least two things. And in terms of spirituality of the heart, we can look at static images of Jesus or statues. But this then is representation of Jesus in action. And that's the great gift, I think, that film and television have been able to offer us. And not only that, the availability, of course, of the information technology these days. I haven't got it here. I did forget to bring it. But last year, commercial break now, a book came out called Screen Jesus. I wanted to call it, as a friend of mine said, From Celluloid to Digital, which I thought was what happened. The American publishers didn't like that. Film and television representations of Jesus. Anyhow, it's Screen Jesus and 300 plus pages, an overview of the Jesus films. And the trouble is, with the internet and the years that it took to do it, you click something and that leads you to some other one you've never heard of, which leads you to something else, and then a lot of them are available. So I will mention some of that as we go through. So two aims at once. So we'll start immediately with the introduction to a documentary which came out in 1991, produced by the Anglican Church in England and Channel 4. And it was the time that I did a book, Movie Christ and Antichrist, and I was just wondering, I hope they had a look at it. But anyway, here it is, and it's a 53-minute documentary. A lot of people have searched for it. I haven't found it ever since, but this was from the ABC back in those days. So this is the introduction to our theme and an introduction to the history of Jesus films.
Special significance of being a child of God.
I know enough to know that it is impossible to write a Jesus story because we don't know anything about this man.
By a curious irony, the machine age would bring us the Word made very human flesh. As the magic lantern, projecting still images of Jesus down a beam of light, began to be replaced by a magical new device that made pictures move. By the end of the 19th century, the film camera was recording history as it happened. When in 1898, Pope Leo XIII had his attention drawn to the camera filming his carriage, he bestowed a papal blessing, almost as though he were baptizing the age of cinema. Among those first turn of the century movies were mime versions of the gospel stories. They were rather like Victorian religious postcards stumbling into life.
Mm-hmm.
soon the new medium's power of illusion and distortion became apparent. Film could not only produce a stormy Sea of Galilee, it could conjure up a submarine Christ who rose from the depths before walking on water. By 1910, the life of Christ was being sold by the reel. Now the gospel story could be spread for commercial gain to the furthest corners of the civilized world. Sensing the propaganda power of the new medium, the church sounded a confident proprietorial note.
These pictures are going to be a great force. It is the age of pictures. See the billboards and the magazines. More and more pictures all the time. The moving pictures are going to be the best teachers and the best preachers in the history of the world. Mark my words, there are two things coming. Television and motion pictures. We must make people think above the belt.
In 1912, with the church's blessing, an American film company called Kalem took their cameras to Egypt and the Holy Land for the first on-the-spot version of the gospel story. These Jerusalem scenes of the slaughter of the innocents were uncomfortably close to what was happening off-camera, as the producer Sid Alcott recalled.
Suddenly, a Mohammedan mob set upon us with clubs. I recognized them as members of a gang who had previously tried to extort money from us. So I whipped out my revolver and made threatening motions with it, and they withdrew.
Jesus was played by an upper-class Englishman called Henderson Bland. Some years later, Bland wrote about the experience in prose that aspired towards the biblical.
To portray Jesus without gross offense to the holiest instincts and feelings of millions meant such a surrender of soul as to make my normal life seem strange to me, and my immediate memory is alien.
In Hollywood, 4 years later, D.W. Griffith, the man who turned the rough carpentry of film into a sophisticated art, was attracted by the Jesus story. He used it as one of four separate narratives set in different periods of history, from Babylon to the present day. Griffith's backers became alarmed by his expanding budget and his indelicate treatment of scenes like the wedding at Cana. He seemed to be implying that Jesus was the life and soul of the wrong kind of party. But since there was gospel authority for wine drinking, Griffith was allowed to keep the scene in, provided he added a subtitle that got Jesus off the alcohol charge. Silver screen turned water into wine. America, led by the Christian temperance movement, was
I suppose that proves that one picture is worth a thousand words. That we've gone through 20 years of the history of film by the time we come to Intolerance. A couple of things about the clip. The people who spoke about making a Jesus film weren't identified. The first was Max von Sydow, who played Jesus in The Greatest Story Ever Told. The second one was the scholar Harvey Cox, very popular in the 60s and 70s, 80s. And the third one was Denis Arcand, who made Jesus of Montreal. He's the one who said you couldn't make a Jesus film, but he actually did. Should you ever have access to that documentary, it has clips from most of the main Jesus films up to 1991, up to Jesus of Montreal, except for Jesus Christ Superstar. So the rest are there in one form or another. And I'll mention some of them that we won't be seeing clips from, but they are in that film. Another comment I'd like to make as we start to move through. Henderson Bland, the one who portrayed Jesus as the upper-class Englishman, is a great criticism of the Americans, who reckon that Jesus is always played by at least a middle-class Englishman. So they have difficulty with Robert Powell's accent, or Brian Deacon, who is in the Protestant-backed film Jesus, that they have British accents. I think that non-Americans have difficulty if Jesus speaks with an American accent, but there you are. And the other thing to say, most of the films, in fact, have been made in English-speaking countries. I don't know why that should be. The other country that obviously is very important for Jesus films is Italy. There have been a number of Mexican films, some from the Philippines, but practically nothing, for example, from Spain. And there is one major film in the 30s from France. So it's just one of those things I thought I'd point out as well. And as regards Henderson Bland, and without giving gross offence, in fact, the British censor in 1913 really decreed that there should not be images of Jesus face on screen. He thought it was also unworthy. And that, I think, had an influence, as we'll see. All right, do you see we've been moving into what happened? So you saw the postcards coming to life, you saw the catalogue. So from 1895 till about 1915, that was the kind of thing. That from the manger to the cross that they filmed in the Holy Land in Egypt was 1913. I have never seen the full film, unfortunately, one of the ambitions in life. There was an Italian film, which I have seen, made from 1914 to 1916 called Christus. And it's a full-length feature film. So the first of the major Italian films. And I remember seeing it and being reminded, and I should do this, on the technical side, those of you who film or like photography, they had fixed camera on a tripod. So until really the invention of sound and the improvements in sound engineering in studios, they're actually confined with their focus. They could maybe just that kind of movement, but not much more. And it amazes me what they could achieve. The Ben-Hur of 1925 is done with fixed camera. It's all in the editing. So you've got a scene of that, you've got a scene of that, put them together. In fact, George Miller in the 70s when he was doing Mad Max. You're not following the chases, you know, on tracking or on a dolly. It's actually in the editing and the pace. So a lot of the action films, that's how they work. Get the adrenaline going. So what do you do? In that scene from the Babylonian sequence in Intolerance, you can see the enormous set. You can see the range of people that you can have in one set. I'm soon going to show you a sequence from Cecil B. DeMille's The King of Kings, and you'll be able to see what happens, again, with that fixed camera. But I remember in the Christus, they had the Magi coming, several thousand of them, I think. But what they did was get people come down a hill and go zigzag across the hill as they came down, so that you actually seem to see a cast of thousands, even though it was just fixed like that. Now, they seem quaint today. And maybe as you show a clip like the one we're going to see from DeMille, people are going to say, did they really make films like that? You know, this shock of some, you know, younger audiences. It's in black and white. Shock horror. Or a friend of mine says, with his children now, as he takes them to see an animated film, it is in 3D, isn't it? So the sensibilities change. So adjusting for that. Now, with Intolerance, D.W. Griffith did an important thing. He actually introduced Jesus' story into feature filmmaking, virtually for the first time, allowing for Christus, but in English language. And so the story of Intolerance, and I didn't bring a clip, but it's Intolerance is available on DVD, 3-hour film. Four different stories, but one of which is the Jesus film interspersed. And for the seminar, if you had a whole lot of time showing each scene of the woman taken in adultery, there is one from 1916 in Intolerance. But we're going to move to 1927. I don't see a great number of Jesus films during the first part of the 20s. Cecil B. DeMille was a great showman, Methodist background, religious sense, and he made a version of the Ten Commandments in 1923. Remade it, of course, as we know, in the 50s. But he was persuaded then, with the interest in Jesus, to do The King of Kings in 1927, one of the last of the silent films. Now, back to our theme of the films showing us what society was like, what church was like, what the images were like. In a way, the Jesus movie started at the wrong time, because it was a culture of holy cards and plaster statues. And so you have Jesus posing, as we saw in some of those clips. So I think back, what were the expectations? My father was 17 when King of Kings came out, so he probably saw it as a teenager. What was he expecting? How did he think Jesus would be? How do you represent? Now remember, there are very few precedents. When we come to the 1961 King of Kings, we'll have a look at a clip, poor old Geoffrey Hunter had practically no precedence and no mainstream precedent of Jesus speaking on screen. So keeping that in mind, I think the emphasis is a bit on divinity before humanity. I think that's what the tradition was like. Our divine Lord. Interesting listening to some of our older confreres referring to Jesus. Our divine Lord. So there's that kind of emphasis. And Harvey Cox said, you know, how do you represent someone who is fully human but has that presence of God through incarnation? Let's see how you manage with H.B. Warner in 1927, The King of Kings. DeMille was flamboyant. The film starts with Mary Magdalene, rather lavish colour sequences, and she has a very big house, and she gets into her carriage, which is drawn by zebras. Sorry, it was an American film. Drawn by zebras. So the zebras, and she does say, "We are off to visit a carpenter," and off she goes. So that's the atmosphere in which it starts. This particular scene is a longish one, but it's the first of three scenes I will show you of the woman taken in adultery. If anybody ever seen The King of Kings, this one? Anyhow, I hope it'll be an interesting surprise. 1927. Obviously, by that stage, they had different styles of screenwriting, of course. So you notice then the use of language that is not everyday language. The assumption then that you communicate biblical stories with "thou breakest this," that kind of language. The other difficulty, of course, was the style of performance. And remember, we're 30 years in from the Lumiere brothers, so 1927, and the acting has to be without communicating by speech. So it's mime, and it's very much stage and theatrical presentation. So the woman being upset, she just doesn't look sad. It's that kind of gesticulating performance, which again may put some people off, although they underestimate some of the acting styles of some people still today. But it's a particular tone. So the language... Yes.
The Lumiere brothers, that was the beginning of cinema, was it? Like?
Yes, in 1895 in Paris they showed. There were a lot of people working on cameras, a lot of people working on projectors at the Lumiere brothers in December 1895. And it was the... just as an aside, the first film made in Australia... And they were very short because of the length of the celluloid and what could go through the projector. If you were to guess what the first documentary in Australia in 1896 it was? It was the Melbourne Cup. So the Melbourne Cup 1896. The Salvation Army did set up a film unit in the late 1890s, and for 10 years did some biblical sequences. They combined, say, a lecture, some slides and some film clips, but then it was shut down in 1909. So there is a religious background in Australia, but it did start with the Melbourne Cup. The thing would be, say, if you were doing the workshop on images of Jesus and the woman taken in adultery, get people to talk to one another, and the basic question is, what did you like, what appealed to you, what didn't? I've found that that's sufficient. People will actually start talking. Was there anything that, as you looked at that clip, say that appealed to you in the way Jesus was presented? Anything you liked?
I liked it, but he was in white and all the others were in a sort of a dull grey, so it was featuring in that way.
Yes, and his haircut was different from the later. A lot of people focus, as the day goes on whether Jesus touches the woman or not. That seemed to me very human, that one.
Yes, I thought it was very tender.
Very tender, touching her and her hair. Yeah. And whether Jesus lifts her up, those kinds of things. Which then does enable people to say, my expectations of Jesus are that he be tender, and I'm disappointed if I don't see him tender. If you were to say, let's have a day of faith sharing, tell us what you think of Jesus. Oh, I have to do the shopping today, sorry, can't come. Show a clip and you have to say, excuse me, we better stop the discussion now, because people do want to talk. So it's the personalized response that enables people to say, enables people to reveal something of their heart spirituality via response to a sequence like that. Is that all right? Cecil B. DeMille had a priest, Daniel A. Lord, S.J., on set each day for Mass. There were ecumenical and interfaith prayers. And it was, I think, you know, one of the peak religious films of the first 30 years. He had H.B. Warner, the actor, with a separate caravan, allegedly, so that he could keep the atmosphere of Jesus, not with anyone else. So there's a spirituality statement in itself. So is that all right? I think it raises those questions. Moving now to 1961. Hope you all got a shock by saying that. There are no mainstream portraits of Jesus in popular American films from for King of Kings 27 to 1961, King of Kings with Jeffrey Hunter, which seems to me a most extraordinary experience, which year by year I still can't quite fathom. There was a French film, Golgotha, in 1935. Protestants were actually making films during this period with actors performing the role of Jesus, but they were not mainstream releases. So The Great Commandment of 1939, which you can watch in full on the internet. The Pilgrim film, 1948, which is also there. There was a black Jesus in 1941 in a film called The Blood of Jesus, which is also available. You can watch in its entirety. The internet has certainly provided an extraordinary amount of material. Some of the Mexican films from that period, if you can get them up, sometimes they're difficult to put in the code, but they're there somewhere. But in mainstream, certainly in American film, and then you think, you had the crash of Wall Street in 29 and you have the Depression. Surely a religious film would have cheered people up or given them something. You have World War II, no Jesus film. You wonder why. Then came television, and no Jesus film. In fact, there's no mainstream biblical film between DeMille, King of Kings, and DeMille, Samson and Delilah in 1949, which Foxtel still show. The one with Hedy Lamarr and Victor Mature. There was Quo Vadis in 1951, which caused great excitement for us when we were kids going to see Quo Vadis. There was David and Bathsheba with Gregory Peck and Susan Hayward in 51. But then came television, and the need to get people out of their houses, away from their couches, with bigger, brighter films and longer, and widescreen processors. And if you were on a quiz and they asked you what was the first CinemaScope film in 1953, and of course you know the answer is The Robe. So The Robe was the first CinemaScope film. And for those who weren't particularly religious, the second one was Betty Grable, Marilyn Monroe, Lauren Bacall in How to Marry a Millionaire. Remember in Sydney, in George Street, The Robe was at the Regent and How to Marry a Millionaire across the street at the Plaza, providing entertainment for all audiences. But you see Jesus only at a distance in The Robe and at the cross, Demetrius at the foot of the cross, and it's raining and the blood flowing down. This reticence about presenting Jesus. Then the biblical films started to multiply. There was Demetrius and the Gladiators, follow-up to The Robe. There was The Big Fisherman with Howard Keel as Peter. And at the beginning of the 60s, there was a Pontius Pilate made in Italy with a very interesting sequence. Just let me tell you it. Jesus is being interviewed by Caiaphas, played by Basil Rathbone, and there is a close-up of Jesus' eyes. And then when Pilate washes his hands of Jesus, he looks into the bowl, and there are the eyes of Jesus looking at him. So, beginning of the 60s, a bit different. There was Barabbas, quite some good sequences in Barabbas, with Anthony Quinn as Barabbas. Let's have a look at a clip of the last major of these Jesus suggested rather than Jesus seen. So we're in Ben-Hur, and
paper was not there to say which scene it was.
Oh, I'm sorry, it's in here. It's 18. Here are all these FBI notices, which at times one can't avoid. So Ben-Hur was 1959, and it got the Oscar for Best Film, as did Charlton Heston for Best Actor. There are two sequences in Ben-Hur focusing on Jesus. This is to distract you from the FBI warnings. The first one is at Nazareth, which we're now going to look at. I presume most people have seen Ben-Hur at some stage. So this is when he's in need of water and he comes across the stranger, the carpenter in Nazareth. The second one, of course, is during the Way of the Cross. So I'll mention that after we look at this one. So that's, you see Jesus that way. This is 1959.
So he doesn't pan up to his face next?
Not at all. They film it, actually, he stares out the centurion at the end as they're leaving, and the camera is over his shoulder. So you only see the back of his head and the centurion's response to him.
So when did this not show his face phase come? Because in 27 they showed his face.
Yes, but whatever happened after 27... and that idea of the British censor that you didn't show Jesus like that, it prevailed until 1961. We're about to look at the first Jesus face on in mainstream films since the 20s. So, but that's a fine example, and the music helps it. God help me, the shadow of Jesus, again with the hair. And the parallel scene, which we won't show this morning, is during the Way of the Cross, when Ben-Hur is there and he's moved with compassion as Jesus falls. He gets the water, comes and recognises that it's Jesus. And again, you don't see his face at all.
Peter, just a question related to this. The Catholic tradition we talked this morning about iconic and aniconic approaches or religious traditions. The Protestant tradition was certainly one strain that was very much against statuary, iconography, representations of the divine. How did that play? Did that play out in cinema, in film?
No, because as I mentioned, between the two King of Kings, it was the Protestant filmmakers in America who did show Jesus face on in The Great Commandment, the Pilgrim film, another one called Day of Redemption, and The Redeemer in the 1950s. Father Patrick Peyton, whose cause for beatification has been introduced, Holy Cross priest, with family theatre. He had a lot of Hollywood friends, and I had thought he showed Jesus face on, but some time ago I looked at the Passion film that he did, but it's like Ben-Hur, which is surprising. Now, what made the difference by 1960? Again, I'm not sure. Whether it was the Italians starting to experiment like Barabbas, but this is what happened. It's only 52 years ago. It's a comparatively short time that we've had mainstream films, and the King of Kings, no, the which one, has been showing on Foxtel every other week. It's extraordinarily popular, this one. It's the first time, actually, people saw Jesus in colour, face on a widescreen, speaking. Only 52 years ago.
The real Jesus, isn't
it? Well, at least he's got a modified American accent, so he's real enough. Geoffrey Hunter, you don't envy him because, as I suggested, there are no precedents that he can look at. So I'm going to start, just show you a very short clip, the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount. Look at the body language. It's not the first time that he speaks in the film, but I thought it was symbolic. So what do you do when you come to the top of the hill? You remember the statue. And that's how you stand. Well, that's how the filmmaker directed Geoffrey Hunter. So we really, there's a lot more as the film goes on, obviously. But it seems to me it reminds me of the limitations of the imagination at that particular time. So you heard a little bit of his accent as well. There are a lot of very good things, I think, in The King of Kings. It was fashionable to turn up your nose at it. It was just a big spectacular and all the rest of it. And in many ways it is. But as I say, there are quite a number of... His visit to John the Baptist in prison is a creative scene that we don't think about. So... I'd recommend glancing at it again, but see it within its limitations. But it's only half... I'd taken final vows just before the film was released. So it's... not yesterday, the day before yesterday, so to speak. Now, what do you do after you've got King of Kings? Next off the mark was Pier Paolo Pasolini in 1964 with the Gospel According to St. Matthew. And this is quite the opposite. Black and white, it's very stark, it uses the gospel text alone, though he does make more of the massacre of the innocents than perhaps Matthew has in the Gospel, a very stern amateur legal student from Spain as Jesus, and doesn't smile too much at all, except with the children, and walks very fast. One stage he's striding across the countryside, the apostles trying to keep up. You know, foxes have holes, but the birds of the air have their nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head, and they're trying to move on. It's the favourite of film critics, black and white, stark, not Hollywoodised. So it's a very striking film. Next year it'll be 50 years old. Won the organisation which I headed up later. It won its prize in Venice in 1964. So well acclaimed by church. But I think a lot of popular audiences find it, you know, very, very sombre. So Pasolini was a Marxist, a novelist, was caught in Assisi on the 4th of October 1962, which is the day I have in my passport, but we were in Sicily on the boat. John the 23rd did a terrible thing with enormous consequences. He went travelling. And look what's happened ever since. He got the train to Assisi on the Feast of St. Francis. The crowd was so big that Pasolini was visiting, so the story goes, and he was in the hotel room. He got out the Gideon Bible and was looking at it, started to read Matthew's Gospel, and the justice and sternness appealed to him, and he made the film and dedicated it to John the 23rd. In the meantime, Protestant interests in the United States went for a book by Fulton Ausler called The Greatest Story Ever Told, filled it with film stars, which in one sense is useful because you can identify who's who. You've heard the story about John Wayne, have you? He was the centurion at the foot of the cross. And his one line is, "Truly this man was the Son of God." And the joke is that George Stevens, the director, said to him, "Duke, could you put a bit more awe into it?" "Okay. Awe, truly this man was the Son of God." Apocryphal, maybe. Anyway, there are some terrible scenes in it. A lot of good ones. If Shelley Winters comes on as the woman who's cured, fast forward. I'm cured. Oh, anyway. It was filmed in Utah, so they used Utah locations. Here's the sequence.
What year is this one, Peter?
65. And was not a box office success. But it gets a lot of replay. Here's another version of the woman taken in adultery to add to what you saw in DeMille's film.
Treat this woman so.
What has she done
to deserve this?
She was caught in the act of adultery.
It's true.
Carol Baker.
Okay.
You have judged her rightly. She is guilty of adultery.
There are calls for her to be stoned.
Yes. Let him among you who is without sin cast the first stone. Speaks against you now, Mary. Neither do I. Go your way and sin no more.
Sin. 1965, Max von Sydow as Jesus. How does he come across? 6 foot something Swedish actor with an accent. It's one of the mysteries of casting, I must say. Carol Baker there as Mary, Salminio the disciple, helping her up. So this is again quite interesting if you're doing the seminar. So you could have done Intolerance, which we didn't see, then DeMille. There is a scene in King of Kings, which I don't think is a very good one. She rushes away from people and is up against a wall. And in fact, Geoffrey Hunt as Jesus doesn't touch her at all and goes off. Then this one, chronologically. One of the interesting things, and I didn't notice it at first, but when he says, you know, whoever is innocent cast the first stone, in fact, he's the one who casts the stone. He throws it down, but not at her, which I think is an interesting variation on the theme. So again, the how much humanity, how much divinity, what comes across in that particular scene. All right, so that's that was just as Vatican II was ending, this film came. And I think it represents the kind of churches up till then. After Vatican II, there was a lot of Jesus movement, a kind of charismatic, happy-clappy, all those kinds of let's rejoice in Jesus, out of which came Godspell, out of which came Superstar. So Superstar, the first records are being released in the late 60s. And just a reminder that Tim Rice and Andrew Lloyd Webber were in their late 20s. Seems to me extraordinary looking back. So the insights that Tim Rice had in writing the lyrics and Andrew Lloyd Webber, and they'd already done Jesus and the Technicolor Dreamcoat, Joseph and the Technicolor Dreamcoat, and then this one. Now the film...
First, Peter, Godspell or...
Superstar. Well, more or less at the same time. I remember we all went to see the stage production of Superstar in 1970. And the production in Australia of Godspell in 72. So we've got a Superstar first. But both films came out in 1973. Let's have a look at one of the songs from Superstar.
Oh, that's the one.
It's the one you have to... The chaptering of... The chaptering of the DVD of Superstar is not particularly helpful. They start a chapter with the Last Supper, and they've kind of got to we've got to move through it.
That's Jesus of Nazareth.
Yes, that's Jesus of Nazareth. Stop it, we'll do that. Time is.
John the Baptist came out eating bread and water.
Yes, I've got my eye on the time, of course, which is one of the things. How much we'll show. Let's stay in the 70s. We might come back to Superstar if there's time. The Italians then made another Jesus movie in 1975, The Messiah, directed by one of their top directors, Roberto Rossellini. Not particularly available. I was lucky to see it at, soon after the time it came out. It's a fairly straightforward presentation of the gospel. But in the late 70s, there were three films that came out, and the Protestants and Zeffirelli wouldn't thank me. I'll go to the third one first, The Life of Brian. So The Life of Brian was 1979. Americans thought it was blasphemous. The English had debates. Malcolm Muggeridge came out against it. It was banned from television until the late 90s in England. Came to Australia and everybody enjoyed it. I didn't say it at the time, I didn't want to take away from King of Kings, but of course the parody of the Sermon on the Mount in The Life of Brian is on. I mean, when you see Geoffrey Hunter come up in the thousands, and what did they say in Life of Brian? What did he say?
God bless the cheesemakers.
Yes, blessed are the cheesemakers. Of course, he's not talking about the production of cheese, but industry in general. So there's those kinds of things. So that was the parody of that. In the late 70s, there were two films, one of Catholic origin, the other Protestant. The Catholic one came out first, which is Franco Zeffirelli's miniseries for television and a cut-down version for the screen, Jesus of Nazareth. And for a while there, Jesus looked, in many people's imagination, like Robert Powell. It's hard to remember the effect, but I know in Latin America and Spain, it was extraordinarily popular. And people used to do talks with slide presentations from Jesus of Nazareth. It was very, very popular. And Robert Powell speaks absolutely beautifully. We had to interview him. And Channel 7, we were over there to... I'd done a review of it, but then we had an interview. And then they all went to lunch. I thought, unthinkable now. They all laid down tools, went to lunch, 40 minutes. Robert Powell stayed with us and talked and told us how he was Anglican, and the Eucharist scene brought back all kinds of memories to him and how he should play it. And then they came back and the publicist says, let's go. Now I saw him, he did this behind his back to the publicist. And I saw whether he meant give us 5 minutes or hang on, but he did. And he stayed for the interview, which saved the program. So great admiration to acknowledge Robert Powell. This is one of my favourite scenes from Jesus of Nazareth. In the past, you're all too young, but when Joseph of Arimathea speaks, right around the room, you could hear the older ladies in the audience, James Mason, James Mason, James Mason, James Mason. Some of you might know who James Mason is, but he was very popular in the past. This is an amalgam of Luke chapter 10, and then Luke chapter 7.
What year, Peter?
78. Well, 77 was ready. Paul VI, by the way, had asked Lord Grade, the Jewish producer, to do it. He produced a Moses with Burt Lancaster. And in Jesus Christ Movie Star, there is an interview with Lord Grade explaining how Paul VI asked him to do this.
Is this the right one? 53.
John the Baptist came neither eating bread nor drinking wine, and who said he was possessed by devils? Here I am, drinking and eating freely with you. No doubt you'll say I'm a glutton and a drinker, friend of the tax collectors and the sinners.
Rabbi, you do us an injustice. We respect your achievements, and we understand their importance. But to what extent are you prepared to accept our laws? We hear that you heal the sick on the Sabbath. You want our people not to rest on the Sabbath?
If one of you had a sheep and it fell into a pit on the Sabbath day, wouldn't you go and get it out?
But
God made the Sabbath for man, not man for the Sabbath.
No, we understand that. We understand what you're trying to say. But is it not confusing to the other people? We live by the law. If we accept the law to be ruled by exceptions, then we are lost.
Today, if it hadn't been for the severity that we learned from Moses, we would not have our laws, we'd not even be a people any longer. But it is the excessive tolerance, the lack of rigidity in your teaching that has made us feel that this is a real danger.
The law gives me security. It's a guide to my whole way of life. A measure for judging this man is right, this man is wrong.
But you should not judge. But you, as a son of Israel, know that we were chosen by God from all mankind to be the holy nation, and for this he gave us our law, the Torah, which is the law of life. And we have to separate ourselves from the sinners and be pure and just.
But who is just in the eyes of the Lord? What is the heart of the law?
Hear, O Israel, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy strength. This is the greatest commandment.
You said well. You are not far from the kingdom of God, Joseph of Arimathea. But there is another commandment, no less great. You must love your neighbor as yourself.
But who is my neighbor?
No! Stop it!
What's the matter? Isn't she that woman?
Yes.
That porter.
Yes, it's her.
What is she doing?
This is no place for you, woman. Come, leave quickly.
Simon, sit down.
But Reverend, you know what kind of a woman this is.
Simon, please.
If I had to pick desert island video clips, that would be one. I forget how many times I've watched it and I never tire, and I'm amazed at Robert Powell and the performance. And when he goes like that, you know, it's a masterstroke, so to speak. But when he says those words to the woman at the end, it looks to me as if he's completely unrehearsed, saying them for the first time. Yet he would have rehearsed them. So it's a 7-hour production. I don't know if anybody's ever seen it all the way through. But the other one I like to show is the section on his telling of the prodigal son. And Peter, like the older brother outside the building, and the banquet is at Matthew's house. And I always say, you know, when you see these juxtapositions that Zeffirelli and his writers have made, and St. Luke in heaven looking down saying, why didn't I think of that? So it seems to me just an extraordinary a piece of filming. There are just so many things in it. And yet, his woman taken in adultery is not as good. It's one of the lesser scenes in it. I much prefer that particular one. That was Anne Bancroft as Mary Magdalene. So we're up then to the end of the 70s. The Protestant film I mentioned is simply called Jesus, has the English actor Brian Deacon as Jesus. It's fairly short, based on Luke's Gospel, it says, but it's got other elements in it. Rather Protestant, Mary doesn't appear too much at all. And yet it's been one of the most popular Jesus, probably the most popular Jesus film of all time. Not in English language countries, but with all the dubbings, I think 14 languages alone in India. And it's been edited, a children's version, a women's version with some scenes added. It's actually the Jesus Project, they refer to it. Came out in the 70s, re-released, I remember, at the end of 98, mainstream, but of course with DVD. It was the film handed out to pilgrims in Rome during the year 2000, the Jubilee year. Not quite sure why, but anyhow, it was a coup for the producers. It moves very quickly. I remember when it was on television, I taped some of it, and it has the temptations in the desert with a literal snake slithering through, and a very English voice says, if you are the Son of God, it asks the questions. So I don't know if they object to Jesus with a middle-class English voice. The snake was upper class. But there's the temptations, Jesus through the desert, Jesus going to Nazareth, saying hello to a little girl, which is the only non-gospel word in it and brings the scene alive. In the synagogue, reading, being hustled out on the hill, going to Capernaum, preaching the parable of the Pharisee and the publican, the miraculous draught of fishes, Peter saying he's not worthy, and that's 11 minutes from commercial to commercial break. It's using the text. I even think that Pasolini is too literal, rather fundamentalist in his reading of the text for the film, and this one is a bit too. So you're up to 1980.
So this is 1980, is it?
79 was the release of the Jesus Project.
And it's the producer was Deacon?
Jesus is played by Brian Deacon, the British actor.
Who was the producer? Zeffirelli did the Catholic one and this one?
Peter Sasti and John Krish. They're expecting the next Jesus film to be The Last Temptation of Christ, but the money didn't come through. It was to be with Robert De Niro. And in fact, there's nothing much in the mainstream in the 80s until 88, 89, with the release of Jesus of Montreal and The Last Temptation of Christ. So Jesus of Montreal is about an actor who portrays Jesus. So there are very interesting Jesus scenes from the Passion Play. In Last Temptation of Christ, it's not a gospel film as such, because it's based on a novel by Nikos Kazantzakis. It's an interpretation. And some of you might remember the extraordinary hullabaloo when it was released. It had a very sensible approach in Australia. Chief Censor John Dickey was a Catholic. He showed it to religious leaders in each state before it was released, asking whether they thought it was blasphemous. Only one religious leader said it was blasphemous. That was the Reverend Fred Nile. Nobody else said it was blasphemous. Joe Bajelke Peterson wanted a restricted certificate in Queensland. Everybody else let it through, and it was a much more sensible release. There were protests outside cinemas, I gather in Sydney, and mainly Greek Orthodox of the extreme right, with placards badly spelt. But this tall man apparently was in Sydney in Pitt Street. This film is blasphemous. Brian is the Messiah. how he survived, I don't know. It's one of those stories that happened.
There were protests at the release of Superstar 2 in Australia.
Not so many. Mainly in the media.
There were some. My cousin was a musician, and he was recording the stage show. He was playing the orchestra in the stage show in Brisbane, and he said recalls placards and protests outside the theatre in Brisbane.
I don't remember any in Melbourne.
Yeah.
So it's again from state to state, I presume.
Yes, Queensland.
Oh, can't say those things about Queensland, at least to Canberra. Let's have a look at the stoning sequence from The Last Temptation of Christ. It starts with Judas walking along with Jesus, threatening him.
Just so there's no mistake, I'll go with you until I understand. But if you stray this much from the path, I'll kill you.
Never sinned.
Oh. Which one of you people has never sinned?
Whoever that is, come up here and throw these.
I have nothing to hide.
Good.
Take this. It's bigger.
Be careful, Zebedee. There is a God. He's seen you cheat the workers. He's seen you with that widow. What's her name?
Judith.
Aren't you afraid God will paralyze you if you lift that stone? That your arm will wither? You lose all strength.
We're 60 years on from DeMille. Zeffirelli was 50 years on from DeMille. Zeffirelli was 16 years after Jeffrey Hunter. The superstar scene, and I wanted to show you the Agony in the Garden scene where he actually climbs the mountain and screams. One of my desert island clips. Was only 12 years after Jeffrey Hunter. So whatever happened in the 60s and into the 70s, the sensibilities about images of Jesus on screen changed considerably. It's very interesting to think all the things that were going on. And you can see, can't you, there's a great shift to the humanity of Jesus from the divinity. So think of the images, the cards, the statuary, the art, at least in the Western world, from that era. I should say, and I have only a little time to mention it, but from now on, there are films made in India, Africa, and Bangladesh about Jesus. Not too many. that if you ever come across that book, Screen Jesus, I've tried to give descriptions and indications about all of those that were done. 90s was rather quiet because everybody had their video camera and people were making their own Jesus movies. I remember going to a meeting and we were shown Peter the Rock from the Solomon Islands, and it was filmed on a beach outside Honiara. And I won't show that scene. The only other one we'll show now will be Son of Man. Time. But anyhow, the exuberance, a Melanesian gospel story. And I remember when Peter was chosen, the leaps of joy he had leaping along that beach were quite exuberant. So there are only mainstream Jesus films at the end of the decade coming up to the millennium. But there were a lot of independently made films, remember Protestant groups in South Africa, a lot of which is on the website. So if you see the names of the films in that book, you can generally bring quite a number of them up. Quite interesting ones. A complete gospel of Matthew, for instance, visualised and narrated, which corresponds then to a film which we haven't time to see, The Gospel of John from 2003, which is the complete text narrated by Christopher Plummer. And at the end, it's the last of the scenes I show of the woman taken in adultery. And it's presented fairly literally, but quite dramatically.
Sorry, Peter.
That's from South Africa. So it's quite dramatic. It's not a film you would sit through from cover to cover, so to speak. It's the same then with, you wouldn't read the Gospel of John straight through in one sitting. The story was told of two priests in America who went to see Gospel of John in the cinema and had to go to the toilet. And it was about chapter 10. And one of them said, gee, I can hardly wait to 16:4. So it's a bit of an endurance. But to see it in parts, it's well worth seeing. So around the 1999-2000 comes one of my favourite films, which I don't have here at the moment. It's called Simply Jesus. It was produced for television, screened in 1999 at a film festival in Rome at the Gregorian University, and the cast met John Paul II, who made an address about the film. Jeremy Sisto, I think, is particularly good as Jesus. It has Gary Oldman as Pontius Pilate, Jacqueline Bisset as Jesus' mother, Mary. Goes for almost 3 hours. I find in showing clips from that these days, it's one of the most popular. People respond very well to it. So that's Jesus. There was also an animated film called The Miracle Maker, with animation done in Russia and in Wales. Three-dimensional puppetry, two-dimension sketch for flashback scenes, especially the infancy narratives or the parables. Those were the kinds of things at the beginning of the century. The Gospel of John, directed by Philip Saville in 2003. And then, of course, what happened then in Jesus films?
Mel Gibson.
So The Passion of the Christ, 2004. Whether you like it or not, and I've seen it 3 times now, I didn't intend to, but I was asked to see it, he certainly knows how to make films. Certainly knows how to make films. I had a clip, and it had me time. It was the crucifixion. But as the crucifixion, there are these little flashbacks to the Last Supper, which most people who've seen the film have completely forgotten about. You know, there's no humanity in Passion of the Christ. Won't you remember the flashback where he's throwing water at his mother and he falls and she goes... People seem to have just been so preoccupied with the visual and oral violence. But it was an extraordinary success, and it led to all kinds of religious films being made. Protestants responded extraordinarily to it. So it has been a landmark in filmmaking. There was a black Jesus in The Colour of the Cross and Colour of the Cross 2 in the United States. There was a BBC series called The Passion, not bad, with the actor Joseph Maul as Jesus. There's a series on at the moment, and I haven't seen the Jesus section, the Bible, on Channel 9. They're filming another film about Mary in Tunisia at the moment. There was the Nativity story in 2006, which I would recommend. So since Mel Gibson, it's been an extraordinarily freeing experience that you can show Jesus in many kinds of ways. Now, given the time limits that we have, I'm only going to show one more clip as we finish. And as you've seen, it's from a South African film called Son of Man. It's an English director, but he's working with a group outside Cape Town. In 2005, they did a version of Carmen in modern dress and the language, and they won the Golden Bear at Berlin. And I think it gave them encouragement and some money to make this one. It's only 86 minutes, very limited budget, no parables, for instance, but it's Jesus in a contemporary situation. We've got time for 3 minutes, have we?
Yeah, which chapter was it?
At the beginning.
Oh, it's just the beginning.
Yes.
What year is this, Peter?
2006. So 2006 was a very productive year. Nativity story, Colour of the Cross, Son of Man. And here we are. See what you make of this.
Yesu chikalamaje ave zisonga.
Thank you.
kuyika kuba balo mthiko uyabona uyakuthabatha esizalweni uzala kunyana umthiyo igama elinguyesu umoya uyingcwele uyakudla phezu kwakho athi namandla osenyangweni akusikelele kungoko loo nto ingcwele zalwa nguwe iyakubizwa ngokuba ngunyana kathixo
Sorry to interrupt that different version of the Magnificat. So that's 2006. As you can see, and I should mention there was a Filipino version called Cristo in 1996 doing the same kind of enculturation of the gospel in local customs. But you can see by now, filmmakers have been able to free themselves from any filmmaking stylistic restrictions, even spirituality restrictions, and they've become much more creative. And so, just when you think, you know, 1890s, clips, catechetical approaches, the very literal approach, the fixed screen in the silent era, the breakthrough, I suppose, with Intolerance and The King of Kings, at least the story is being told, 34 years of absence, and in the 52 years since, rather staid, creative with Pasolini, old-fashioned with the greatest story ever told. Jesus Movement, Superstar, which again was on stage recently and to great acclaim, so it's still alive and Godspell. And then Zeffirelli, I suppose, one of the definitive Jesus films, The Protestants, with the Brian Deacon film, parody with Life of Brian. And then, I suppose, breakthroughs in imagination in the 80s with The Last Temptation and Jesus of Montreal. The various homemade and great variety of possibilities in the 90s, culminating in the Jesus for television, the Jeremy Sisto, the Miracle Maker. There was also a Mary Mother of Jesus made at that time for Millennium Television as well. And the Gospel according to John, which had circulation. Mel Gibson, all kinds of spirituality, theological breakthrough, whether you agree or not. And then all this kind of creativity corresponding, I suppose, to a theological growth and change throughout the century, a growth in spirituality, which enables people to respond personally, which I suppose we call spirituality of the heart.